Hello everyone, I'm Divyashri Tambre. I'm the Institute Secretary for Academic Affairs and Head of Student Support Services for the session 2021-22. I'm also a third year student in the Department of Chemical Engineering. Firstly, congratulations on coming to IIT Bombay, and I welcome you all to the technical orientation. The aim of this orientation is to acquaint you to the different platforms and services that you would be using while your stay at IIT Bombay. We are using a recording that was made last year by Priyanka Bagde, who was the Institute Secretary of Academic Affairs and Head of Student Support Services before me. She will guide you through the different platforms and the various steps that you would have to take. We have also updated the video accordingly to make it fit for this year and have added certain sections. Handing over to Priyanka now.
Hello everyone, my name is Priyanka Bagde and I am a third year student from Electrical Duval. I am the current Institute Secretary of Academic Affairs and the Head of Student Support Services. I'll be conducting this technical orientation for all of you today so as to familiarize you with all the different softwares that you might be requiring here during your stay at IITB. So I'll just share my screen in a moment. So Student Support Services is a part of the Undergraduate Academic Council at IITB, and it takes care of all the basic requirements of students across all the years. In today's orientation, you will get to know about all the different important academic resources which might be useful in an online mode, but they'll also be very important and useful after you come back to IIT. So beginning with the first part, we'll begin with SSO. SSO is basically single sign-on, or fondly called as SSO. So it's mandatory for all the network users here at IITB to enroll into this facility, be it the professors or be it the student or the staff. It's very important for you to register into this if you want to access all the different services that are provided, because without this, you might probably not be allowed to avail of majority of the facilities that would be provided to you by IITB in an online mode. So in this case, there are several different ways of registering using SSO. Like you can use the Google Authenticator app, or you can try to even use an SMS based OTP. So because in order to formulate all of these, I'll be sharing a video with you all right now so that you can understand how the process works. It is basically of using Google Authenticator for SSO, which is a very popular method currently. And after this, I'll be giving you kind of a 5-minute break so that you can also carry out or execute this process on your own for now and see if you're able to do it. Even if you're not able to do it, it's fine. You can do it later on, but this might probably just help you, you know, get on track with the thing.
Today, we will learn how to register for two-factor authentication. Now, Computer Center of IIT Bombay is introducing a new way to provide more security to the LDAP user by using SSO. That is single sign-on. This feature will be introduced for all applications in the coming month. So open up your web browser, type sso.iitb.ac.in. Sign in using your LDAP ID and password. Click on Manage Accounts. Click on Register for Two-Factor Authentication. And click on Register. Enter your password again. Click on Continue. Now open up your mobiles. Go to Play Store and search for Google Authenticator. Install the app. Click on Open. Click on Begin. Skip. And click on Scan a Barcode. Allow. This will scan the barcode and generate an OTP. Now write this OTP in the web browser. And click on Register. This is how you register for two-factor authentication. Let's log out now and check the login process. Now the next time you try to log in, it will directly ask for an OTP. So open up the app and write the OTP to log in. This is how you can log in using two-factor authentication. If you want to change your mobile phone, deregister and then register using a new mobile phone. You can easily deregister by clicking on deregister for two-factor authentication and writing your password. Please note that do not uninstall the app without deregistering. If you're handling more than one account, like one functionary and one personal, you have to register for both. If you happen to lose your phone or your phone gets stolen, contact Computer Center for any help by logging on to cc.iitb.ac.in or by using the helpline number 2677. Thank you for watching.
So coming on to the next platform, which is Moodle. Moodle is probably going to be your most used platform here at IITB, even after you come back to the institute. It's a very common platform for students to interact with the professors related to all their different courses. You have to log in into Moodle using your LDAP ID and password. I'm going to emphasize time and again that your LDAP ID and password are really very important, and you should not forget them because they'll be required for accessing more than 90% of all the services that probably IITB has to offer. And please do not share this LDAP ID with anybody else, and because there might be a few places which contain personal information related to maybe your phone numbers or your addresses or anything, grades, anything. So don't share it with anybody and do not forget it. So moving on to Moodle. Moodle is basically a platform for students to interact with professors, as I already mentioned. You can ask queries, you can download all the video lectures. It's also used as a platform for conducting quizzes by quite a few profs. Now, posting, apart from this, what you can do is you can start a discussion forum on Moodle. And when you do that, you can invite everybody who is registered in the course as well as the professors in the course in order to participate in that discussion. So posting or replying on Moodle basically sends out an email to everybody who is registered for that particular course. So that's one thing that you need to take care of. But apart from this, if you definitely want to contact the prof personally, you can do so. You can email the prof at his personal email ID and try and talk to him and get in touch with him. Since it's a very important platform, I'll try to demonstrate it to you the way it works so that you can again get familiar with the process. And again, I'll be providing you with a short 2 to 3 minute break so that you can explore this website by yourself and try and understand how this works. I've given you the link here as well. You can just type it out in your browsers and you can explore it after I'm done showing how it works. You log in to Moodle, that is at moodle.iitb.ac.in. This is probably going to be like your most used website as a student in IITB. So first we log in using our LDAP ID and credentials. As soon as you log in, you will be actually coming to this homepage, which is basically your dashboard. Here you will be able to view all the courses that you have registered for till now, or at least the ones which are in progress. So these are all the different courses that I have registered for this semester. So in your dashboard, you might be able to see PH107 or CS101 or things which are similar to that. So first, let us move on to say one of the courses. Let it be the course of microprocessors. Now, when you go to microprocessors, here you will see how the professor has actually uploaded all the lecture slides of all the theory that he has covered till now. Many a times it is often divided week-wise, where if you go on that particular week, you would be able to see what all he has uploaded, say two of these video lectures he has uploaded, and then if there are any slides, they would be uploaded here as well. So if you go to the announcement section here, the announcement section is basically a place where the professor is going to post in any announcement that he wants all the students to attend to. So it is this is a section that one needs to look out for. But then the good thing is that many a times whenever the professor is going to make an announcement, it will automatically come to your webmail account, which I would be covering up soon. So you don't have to particularly come back to Moodle again and again and have a look at the announcements. So now let us go back to the course and let us move on to this discussion forum. Now, if you look at the discussion forum, the good thing about this discussion forum is that suppose you want to discuss a particular topic, or if you're having a doubt in a particular topic and you either want to, kind of post an open question both to your professor and to your students, or to your classmates who you probably want to answer. So in this case, what we can do is add a new discussion topic. When we add a new discussion topic, you can give a subject to that particular message. You can type in the message. You can also try and attach any image, any video or any audio that you want. That is as per your requirements and the question that you want to ask. And once you're done, you can post to the forum. Now, once you post to the forum, what happens is that this particular message would be posted into the discussion forum for everybody to view after 30 minutes. So it's kind of providing you with some time for editing in case you feel there is a mistake in the message that you posted and you want to edit it. So that's a good way of doing it. So once you do that, what you would notice is, like, just like all these topics which have been added by, say, different people here, you would also be getting a discussion topic that is going to be added by you. And therefore, the started by would be your name. So in such case, what happens is that once such a discussion topic has been started, it again comes on everybody's webmail account. So that is why people, they automatically get notified in case if there is any question that is posted, or if, you know, there is any topic which is added to this discussion forum. Going back to the dashboard, we can have a look at all the quizzes. Now, this is the place where you can actually see all the pending assignments or see all the pending homeworks that you have. Like, I have two due on, say, Friday, 6th of November. So if I click, say, on one of them, I would be able to see the assignment. That is the PDF which I can download from here. And if I have to submit that assignment, I just need to go to add submission. And I can either drag or drop files, or otherwise I can simply add or upload a file from here. And the fields are pretty easy enough to understand. Coming back to the dashboard. Now, suppose you again want to go to a particular course and you want to view your grades for that course. You'll click on that course as I did. Then you'll click on these three lines here and then you will go to grades. Now, the thing is that I haven't been allotted any grade on Moodle as yet for this particular course. So you can see everything is empty. But many a times what happens is that if you are giving quizzes on Moodle, or if the professor wishes to upload, he'll upload all the grades or all the marks for all the assignments and the homework that you have done in this particular tab, which is the grades tab. As you can see, there are several other subfields which are also present here. But then the most important one would be this grades tab. It would be the dashboard, which takes you back to the original course page as well. So this was all for Moodle. As you can see, here are like a list of all the online users who have used it since the past last 5 minutes. And I think this is all you would be needing for at least getting started. So try and explore more. Take 2 or 3 more minutes right now and log into the website and try and explore all these different features out. Coming on to ASC, ASC is the application software cell. It is another website that you would have to access. Since it's basically used for registration, it's widely used rather, I should say, for registration, you might be able to access it to its full capacity after second year or, you know, including second year onwards. But for now, I think you should just familiarize yourself with what the website is and what all things you might see there. This is the website where you would be able to see all your grades, all your academic details, all your personal information, which you must have verified pretty recently. And you can view all, one interesting aspect of it is that you can view all the grading statistics for different courses. Now, don't worry if you don't understand. I'll be, you know, very soon showing it all out to you and how it works and all. You know, even into the semester, you might have to fill in the course feedback form for your professors. Say it might be at the middle of the semester or it might be at the end of the semester. So ASC is the only way of doing that. Again, you need to log in into ASC using your LDAP ID and credentials. So you can understand how it's almost used everywhere, your LDAP ID. To asc.iitb.ac.in. When you do, you need to fill in your LDAP password. And you also need to fill in the OTP that you are going to get from your SSO authentication. Now here to point out, the authentication method that I'm using is an OTP based authentication method. You can even use an SMS based or any other method highlighted. So let us move on to login, again using your LDAP credentials. So this is the way your homepage is going to look like. Let us get to academics. In academics, you can have a look at your academic or personal details and you can move on to view. That is where you would be able to see all the courses that you have taken till now, as well as your CPI, SPI, etc. Then ASC is majorly used since for registration purposes. You might not be using it a lot in your first year, but it will come very handy in your second year, third semester onwards, when you have to register for courses on your own. So there is one more very interesting insight that you can check, and which is grading statistics. So basically, I'll show you what it is. Go to all about courses and then go to grading stats. So here what you can do is you can try and search for any course that has been conducted till now. Say probably I want to go on for semester 2 and say I want to check out the course EE338 and I submit it. So basically what I see is the score which is going to be given for that particular batch, which was 2018 and semester 2. So I can see the number of people who have got every particular grade. So, you know, sometimes it helps in getting an idea of the kind of grading which might be done by the professor, if the professor has remained the same, because professors keep on changing. So that's an interesting thing that can be explored. And generally, it's not very, first years are not very concerned with ASC. But then you might want to explore a few features out here as well, because generally as your semester progresses, you might even have to fill in the course feedback form for all your course instructors, which also needs to be done on the same website, that is on ASC itself. Okay, moving on to external ASC. External ASC is pretty much similar to ASC itself. It is just that it has a subset of all the functionalities of ASC. It is primarily used by all the students in order to view their grades for all the different courses, and you can have a look at your personal information. As a snapshot itself is showing right now, you can see all the CPIs and all the SPIs, etc., for all these different semesters. And since third semester onwards, you can even pre-register using external ASC, but it is not something that you should concern yourself right now with. Probably one thing that is going to be very important to you is regarding fee payments next semester onwards. Your hostel fee payments or even be it your tuition fees, you would be paying it via the external ASC, and I'll be showing it to you in detail how you're going to do that. And I'll be giving you a 3-minute break after this so that you can try and understand how ASC and how external ASC exactly work, and you can just try and explore it a bit yourself. Diving into external ASC and what it is, first you need to come to this particular website, which is portal.idb.ac.in/asc/login, and you need to again log in using your LDAP ID and password. So once you log in, it is kind of very similar to what we saw even in the original ASC, or the one that we just saw before, where you could view all your academic details and your personal details. If you actually go to this tab, you will notice that it is all personal information. But if you actually go to payments, that is the thing which can which concerns you and which will concern you rather every semester from now on. When you need to pay your semester fees, let it be your tuition fees or let it be your hostel fees, there's going to be a link that is going to come up here on external AAC, and you need to click on that and you need to pay your fees for that semester. And external AAC is the only way of doing it. Then you can also view and update your bank account details, as you can see that there are a number of these fields that you need to fill in. But then the thing is that this would be further used, say, for scholarships or say for fee payments, etc. So I haven't filled in yet, and it's not compulsory to do so, but it's a good practice too. And you should be doing it after you get access to your LDAP ID and password.
Coming to the course feedback, twice a semester, the institute provides you with an opportunity to provide feedback on the different courses that you're taking during the semester. A feedback window opens up on external AAC, whose link you can find over here, before the mid-semester and the end-semester examinations. One thing to note about the course feedback is that it is completely anonymized, and the professors aren't able to see the feedback that you've provided before they submit the grades for the course. So you can be assured and you can provide your honest inputs about what you liked about the course and what changes you would like to see in the future. Again, this is a process which is extremely crucial for the academic system at IIT Bombay, as it helps to improve the course, not only for your batch, but especially for the batches which come after you. Another thing is that you would need to have filled in the course feedback when the window opens up to be able to view the grades when they are submitted on AAC. So make sure that you fill it up well within the deadline.
Coming on to Webmail, Webmail is like the email system of the institute. it's like any official communication that you must have received related to your admission procedure till now, it must have been probably via messages, or it must have been via the website, or you know, your parents might have been contacted for it. But right now, after you actually get your LDAP ID and credentials, webmail is going to be the official mode of communication between you and the institute. Once you get your LDAP ID, what happens is that you are even getting an IITB email ID, and that is given by LDAP ID at the rate iitb.ac.in. And the password to this email ID is your LDAP password. So basically now, if you actually, you know, if the dean or if the director wants to communicate with you guys, then in that case, they'll be sending out an email on webmail. They won't be contacting anybody else. So you should at least make it a good practice to check your webmail accounts out once a day so that you don't miss out on any important notifications. And the thing is that, as you can see in the snapshot, that the interface looks very different, and if at least from Gmail, if you have accessed it, but don't worry, you can even integrate webmail into Gmail and you can access both of them together on your phone as well. We'll be providing separate videos for that later, and we won't be integrating it right now, but it's a very easy process and you can definitely do it on your own. And there would be videos to guide you as well. And you can do that by webmail.iitb.ac.in. You again need to fill in your LDAP credentials, so it just shows how important your LDAP ID and password are and the fact that you shouldn't forget it. Okay, the captures might take a bit long. Okay, so once you log in, you can see how it's basically like a mailbox. This is like your inbox. It's showing all the emails that you have received, and you can again compose a mail, or you can go to drafts, or you can even see junk and deleted items. So there's nothing new about webmail as a mailing system. It is pretty much like Gmail or any other mailing system, but then the thing is that it is, as I've mentioned already, it's going to be used for official communication from the institute. Any mail which is going to now come from, say, the director, or say from the dean, or from say the general secretaries, anybody who is belonging to the institute will not come to your email IDs, but it will to your Gmail ID, sorry, but it will rather come to your webmail accounts. So you need to keep on checking your webmail accounts regularly. It is important to check it at least once a day so that you are sure that you are not missing out on any important notification that you might have got. Now, I know that this looks a bit different, but the good thing is that you can even integrate webmail into your Gmail account, that's going to work on both your laptop as well as on your mobile. It's going to work on both. The videos for that would be separately provided at the end. So you can probably have a look at it if you want to integrate it entirely into your Gmail. So coming on to SSO-based webmail. SSO-based webmail is actually not very different from what webmail was. The only thing is that you have two different ways of accessing them. When you come to SSO based webmail, you basically have to log in using your LDAP ID and credentials, just like you did for webmail. But then you would also have to use SSO authentication here. And that is not something which had to be done for webmail. So the logging facilities are a bit different. And you can see that the interface also is pretty different from what we saw in the previous slide. But that's more or less it. It doesn't have a lot of difference in the functionalities between the two. So you can definitely try and explore this. Probably I'll give you a minute so that you can try and understand how it all works and have a look at it at least. Okay, so if you guys have probably lost a bit of a concentration till now, or if you guys feel a bit lazy, I think you should just stay up for this, because I'm coming on to MS Teams now. MS Teams is probably the most widely used app currently. It's used by professors to conduct live interactions. It's used by them to provide you with class materials and even to conduct quizzes and give you assignments. So the thing is that, again, for Teams, you have to use your LDAP ID and password, because an institute is providing you an account on MS Teams, and you can even install it on your mobile. So that's pretty great. Like, you can get all your notifications on the mobile itself. And don't worry, I'm going to go into, you know, a lot of detail related to this entire process and the way it is all going to look like. So you need not be scared about it. And after that, I'll just probably give you a minute or two to digest the fact and at least try and access probably the browser mode of MS Teams. You might not be able to access the download the app immediately right now on your phone or on your laptops, but you can try. Definitely you should give it a try after the orientation. MS Teams is like the most used app currently in the institute. It is used by almost every professor for conducting sessions, live interactions, etc. So I'll get straight into it now. So first, what you need to do is you need to download MS Teams. So I can do that, and I'll go to the website which allows me to. So here you can see there are two options. One is download for desktop, the other one is download for mobile. Now, download for mobile is like you go to your app store or you go to the Android store, you download the app, and then you again log in. The same thing is you download for your desktop. I'm not going to download it all over again because I already have it, but you need to download it, and you again need to log in using the same exact process of LDAP ID, LDAP password, and SSO if that is also required. So once it's going to be downloaded, you can actually come and look at the MS Teams interface, and this is the way it is going to look like. Now, these all are the teams that I've been added to, and they kind of summarize all the courses that I have been a part of. So I'll probably use one of the courses, and let's get to say E301. Yes. So now when you actually go to EE301, what you can notice is that there is this chat window kind of a thing which is provided. And as you can see that the professor in charge is, she can very easily send out probably some announcement or some message, which is going to be visible for the entire class to see. Now, once you actually come to this interface, you need to go into files. Now, if you go into files, you can see that she has uploaded a lot of material. And if you go into class materials further, you will notice that there are lecture videos. There is this lecture PDF thing that I am in currently. You can go in into lecture videos, and you would notice that these all are the different lecture videos she has uploaded in Teams itself. So like, instead of providing us with a drive link, or instead of, you know, using some other medium of sharing her videos, what she has done is she has provided us with the videos here itself in Teams. If you go on to assignments, what you would notice is that there are these completed assignments, and there is this assigned assignment, or the ones which I need to complete, the ones which are going to be due. So as you can notice, if you say probably go to one of the assignments, you can view the PDF here. That is, you can view the assignment here. This is the assignment. And if you need to hand in your work, as in you need to submit the assignment, you need to add work. Oh, sorry, it's a bit slow. So you need to upload it from your device. You can just simply upload it from your device, attach it, and then after that, just click on hand in. Don't forget to click on this hand in, because it's very, very important. Otherwise, your assignment is not going to get submitted. Now, there are these different channels as well which are present. I won't go into the details of this, but then it might come in handy just to know that there are these different channels which are present. So as in, people who are a part of general, they may not be a part of the subgroup 3, which is one more channel that has been created. What you can notice here as well is that the professor is providing all the meeting recordings. As in, many a times professors will conduct live interactions or live lectures with you, and they'll record it then and there itself, and then they'll share it with you. Teams has this facility of doing that. So that is the way they share it. So you just need to download it and you need to view it on your laptop. Now, I might understand that a few of you might not be comfortable with using it on your desktop for a variety of reasons. So there is one more thing that is provided. Google Chrome allows you to access MS Teams on your browser itself. So again, it is the same. I already opened it, but it is again the same process. You can just simply go to Google. You can say MS Teams browser. Use Teams on the web. When you go to use Teams on the web, you can go to this website. It is basically the same thing that I've opened here itself. And what you can see is that the entire thing has loaded on your browser instead of loading it on your laptop. So if for some reason you are uncomfortable and you're not able to open it on your actual desktop, you might open it on your browser as well.
One additional feature on MS Teams that you can use is that if you go to a particular channel and go into the files section for the channel, you can see an option over here which says open SharePoint. Clicking on that should take you to the SharePoint link for this particular channel, where you can access all the different folders and the files which are present over here for this particular course. This provides you with a very good feature, is that you can access this all in your web browser and you don't need to download them on your laptop if you want to save storage. So you can click on any of these videos over here and that should play the video. And over here too, you can download for the same. Another feature which is really useful is that IIT Bombay provides you with access to Office 365 via your LDAP IDs. So if you go to office.com and you click on sign in, I'll just take a moment and sign myself in. So I have already signed in and you can do this through the SSO sign in, which has been shown before. So after you sign in, it has probably already. After you have signed in, you're able to see this interface over here where you can access all the files that you were accessing on MS Teams and which have been shared with you. Additionally, you can also use all of these different softwares such as Word, Excel, or PowerPoint. If you don't have these on your laptop or you don't have a Microsoft license, you don't have to worry. IIT Bombay provides you with an access over here. And additionally, on OneDrive, you have about 1 TB of storage, which is accessible to you. So SharePoint as well as Office 365 come under it. So 1 TB of storage is what you can use to store all the data that you need apart from your G Suite and Big Home data. So over here, you can create a new document which opens up a DOCX file over here right inside your web browser. And there's no need for you to download it.
Coming on to G Suite, G Suite is basically Google Suite and it's very similar to Google Drive. Again, you need your LDAP ID and password here, but just a word of caution, when you're using your LDAP ID, please do not use just your LDAP ID. For example, if your LDAP ID is 123, don't use 123 for logging into it. For accessing G Suite or even for accessing MS Teams, you need to access it as in 123@iitb.ac.in. You need to use the entire thing and not just 123. And then you need to use your LDAP password. Now, many times what happens is that currently a lot of professors follow different ways of sharing their recorded lectures. Some of them might share it via YouTube. Some of them might even just provide, you know, those videos on Moodle. And some of them, they record this and then they provide the links to this to these videos. And they do that via Google Drive or G Suite. The thing is that G Suite is providing you with 1 TB of access or 1 TB of space on Google Drive. So now what you can do is, instead of downloading all these videos on your laptop, you can definitely just simply put them on your drive. So it's not eating up any of your space on the drive, it's on the laptop itself. And the thing is that you can always organize your drive pretty well and it's all going to be very easy to access. So G Suite is something that you guys should definitely explore. Like, it's not just the drive, but you'll be even getting to access, say, the Google Meets. You'll be getting to access sheets, slides, etc., which you'll all be needing pretty soon. So I think I'll give you a minute or two, and first I'll show you how it works, of course. And then after that, I'll give you like 2 or 3 minutes to have a look at it, to just digest it all. And you know, you can even go and have a look. You can at least try logging in into G Suite. It won't take more than 1 or 1.5 minutes to do that. Let me even demonstrate it a bit to you. For example, the first thing that you need to do is again sign in. Now you need to sign in using your LDAP ID and password, like the way I am doing it. This is my LDAP ID. Okay, I must have made, I made a mistake here. Yeah, so it is again taking me to SSO. Now I need to put in that one time OTP which I'm going to get from my authenticator, as I even did before. Oh, this was wrong. Let me check again. Yes, this was the correct one. So now I'm logged in. Now, once you log in, you can actually see all those things, all those facilities which I was talking about being available. First, let me go to the drive. Like I've already mentioned, you have this 1 TB of space that is available on your drive. The good thing is that many times in Sprofs, they actually share their videos via such drive links. What happens is that you can store it on this drive instead of storing it on your laptop, because it saves a lot of space. And you can see I already have a lot of things which are related to different courses on my drive here. You can even try and explore out other things. I'm sure that you might not have used Drive a lot after or at least till 12th. So you might even want to do it right now. You can go and have a look at what Docs do, what Sheets do, what Slides does, because that's going to be a very integral part later on as you actually move ahead in IIT. So I think I'll leave it all to you to explore more. And in fact, I'll give you some time right now to think about it, or at least to see what all these different things are, because it's very interesting and it's going to be very, very helpful, and it's going to help you stay organized as well. So coming on to Zoom and WebEx, I think a majority of you must have at least heard of Zoom, if not WebEx. It's a very famous online conferencing platform. And the thing is that IITB again provides you with an account, as a student account in Zoom and WebEx. So suppose you want to access WebEx, you need to go at the site that I've mentioned here, and you just need to log in using your LDAP ID password, and it's going to be an SSO based authentication over there. And you can even access Zoom similarly, where you just need to go on their website and you need to sign in. These two processes are pretty relatively easy, so I am not demonstrating them to you right now, but it is something that you should definitely give a try. And that is because different professors, again, as I've said, they have different ways of, you know, trying to share all their, or, you know, conduct live interactions or live sessions with students. Some of them might not even use MS Teams, but they might use Zoom or WebEx. So it's always a good idea to get into a habit of accessing all these things so that you're not in trouble at the main moment. Just like Zoom and WebEx, GMeet is also a very common platform that is used by professors to conduct online classes here in IITB. And it is a part of G Suite. So once you access G Suite, as shown before, you can very easily access GMeet. The only thing that you need to do is go to the Google homepage, and after that, click on that dot kind of a thing which is highlighted. On that, you can go and access GMeet further, which is shown in this black square. Or what you can do is directly go to this website that I've mentioned, that is meet.google.com, and there you can directly log in and you can use GMeet further. Coming on to Freshy resources, we've got a lot of requests from students regarding previous year papers, tutorials, slides, etc. So what we do is, we as Student Support Services, every year collect this repository of all the previous year's papers, which might have been taken by different instructors as well. And it is purely meant to aid students in their preparations. It's definitely not a substitute to classes or instructors, but it's going to be a good guide. So for people who want to start early or even during, just before your exams, it's a very, very good means of practicing or solving questions. We'll be sharing this drive link or the Freshy resources through the Student Support Services FB page. So do stay tuned there. And I've also provided the link here as well. Moving on to CDEEP is basically like a repository of videos of IITB. So it allows you to view recordings along with lecture slides of previous offerings of the course. Like if I'm taking up a course, physics course, it might have been taken by a different instructor sometime back. So that video, if it was recorded, it might be present on CDEEP. And I've provided the link to you. Again, you need to access on CDEEP using your LDAP ID and password. Time and again, it's very important to remember your LDAP ID and password. As you can see in the snapshot, there is this view courses section, which has current semester and archived semester. You might find all the previous course recordings in archived semester and all the courses that are being currently recorded in the current semester. So in case you're stuck, if you feel that the pace is just going a bit too fast and it's a bit difficult for you to catch up and you would like to actually have a look at it all over again. So in that case, CDEEP is definitely a good place to go to and try to see if you have a video, because it might help you to understand things quite better.
Coming to NPTEL and SWAYAM, as you learned about CDEEP, while it is restricted to IIT Bombay, NPTEL and SWAYAM is something which is open to everyone and has courses from different IITs, apart from IIT Bombay, and also different NITs. I think the most interesting part about both of these is that you're able to take up courses from different institutes and learn any course that you want out of interest or something that you would have wanted to do for a long time. And you can even get certified for the same. Also, you can tag these courses here at IIT Bombay as part of your curriculum. You can find the details about how to do this on different resources that the Student Support Services develops and also your department websites. Here's a glimpse of the webpage that you can see when you go to NPTEL's website. And you can browse through the different courses and look at the different requirements that they might have. Here are the links provided for your use. Coming to BigHome. BigHome is kind of like Google Drive, but it is based on institute servers. Similar to Google Drive, you can save as well as share different documents and all of the stuff that you want to put up over here. The institute provides you with a certain space which is allotted for you on the institute server. The most important feature that a lot of students use at IIT Bombay is that the Big Home allows you to make your own homepage or a web page where you can host your own website and also your resume or any place for other people outside the institute to contact you. This will, however, require a little bit of web development knowledge, but I think that is something that you can work around. Here's the link for Big Home that you can use to go to the website and also make your own web page.
Coming on to the scholarship portal, it is quite possible that a majority of you who come into the institute want to avail of a scholarship that might be available to you based on your needs or based on whatever factors you're considering. So in that case, scholarship portal is kind of a very right place to first go to. We have basically a repository of all scholarships, all different types of scholarships which would be available to different students, all with their detailed eligibility criteria and all the other details that are present. As you can see in the snapshot, we even have filters provided. So basically, it's just going to make your search process a lot more easier. So this might be your first go-to place in case you want to know what all scholarships might be available to you as a student. So I can understand if a lot of you are having doubts till now, or if you want to go into the details of a few things and you are stuck somewhere, you need not worry about it. You can definitely give this website a visit, which is www.cc.itb.ac.in. It is like your one-stop guide for all the information related to online resources in IITB. You can here check out the FAQs, you can check out the CC services, and you can check out even all the SSO-related FAQs, which are very strongly recommended. It'll basically help you in solving all your problems on your own and solve all the questions you might have related to whatever has been taught to you till now.
This brings us to the end of the technical orientation. Thank you so much for your patience. We hope you found it to be useful. We would also like to extend our thanks to the SSS team of 2020-21 for recording this video last year. If you have any queries or doubts while carrying out all the things that were shown in the video, please feel free to reach out to us and the SSS team. You can reach out to me on the email ID that is shown over here, or you can also reach out to the academic coordinators. The four academic coordinators' contact numbers have been displayed over here. Alternately, you can also contact us via our Facebook and Instagram pages, and you can also look for updates on the different initiatives that we carry out. Scanning these QR codes should lead you to the appropriate websites. Thanks a lot.